Hello YouTube, it's Akrit again, back with another video from the home studio. You know, as a music producer and beat maker and some whatever YouTuber, I think I want to share my first thoughts and impressions of using the M1 Mac Mini for my entire operations in my home studio. I've had it for a month. I'm talking about the 16GB of RAM version with 1.5 TB of storage. So...
Accurate beats.
Yeah. But before we get into this any deeper, I first of all just want to say that I have launched my 5 weeks of beats project, which basically means that I'm going to do weekly live streams on this YouTube channel for 5 consecutive Fridays, starting this Friday, the 21st of May. That's the first one, and then we're going to do 4 more streams after that. The plan here is to produce a 5-track EP on these 5 live streams and then just release the EP as it is, like instrumental beats on Spotify, Apple Music and everything through DistroKid. We're talking straight up sample-based beats. I'm gonna get all the samples from TrackLib, I'm gonna chop them up in Machine or an MPC or whatever and, you know, produce an entire track for every single live stream. Of course, I'm gonna need a little bit of time in between these different live streams to finish the tracks off and mix them and, you know, prepare them to be released, but you're gonna be able to see my entire creative process from start to almost finish on these live streams. 5 weeks of beats live on this channel, and all the videos are also gonna be left on the channel, posted as videos in its entirety, so you can watch them after the fact as well. Hopefully I'm gonna be able to leave a little bit of room here for you guys to participate as well, like helping me to pick out a sample or suggesting different tempos or swing amounts or different sections of tracks or whatever. So keep an eye out on the channel, subscribe if you haven't already, and you know, make sure to join me for these live stream sessions. I think it's gonna be fun. Now back to the M1 Mac Mini. So I've had it for about a month by now, and prior to that I was using my 15-inch 2018 MacBook Pro for everything. And this one has a 6-core i7 processor and 16 gigs of RAM, so it's definitely good enough for anything I need in terms of music making, but at the end I couldn't really trust this one for video editing. And if I can't trust the piece of technology, you know, I need to look into different solutions for that. And that's where this M1 Mac Mini comes into play. The first plan I had was actually to use this one exclusively for video editing because I heard a lot of great stuff about the performance in Final Cut. But when I saw that myself and I experienced how blazingly fast this computer is compared to my old one, you know, I just couldn't help myself from installing at least Logic and Machine, and then I needed the Universal Audio stuff to run my audio interface, and then I installed all the Artorio stuff, and then I installed Reason, and you know, it just really quickly became the one and only computer I felt like I need in my setup. Even the live stream stuff that I do works flawlessly on the M1 Mac Mini, just out of the box. But I don't want to sound too optimistic or positive here because I've had some minor issues running the M1 for everything. Sure, it runs Final Cut and Logic just like nothing else. It just works. Everything just runs as it should, and I haven't had any issues with that. However, using a DAW almost always means that you're also using some plugins or instruments from third-party developers and manufacturers. And that's where I see a lot of people having issues with this new platform of computers. Honestly though, most of the stuff that I use on a regular basis inside of Logic works just fine. Some stuff aren't 100% compatible, some stuff runs in Rosetta 2, and some stuff runs natively on the M1 chip itself. And to be honest, I don't really care whether it runs natively or in Rosetta 2, as long as it works and performs as I kind of want it to perform. So using Machine Plus as a controller for the machine software on the M1 Mac works flawlessly, no issues there at all. But using the MPCs in controller mode for the MPC software on it though, well, it just doesn't work right now. The software itself runs just fine on the computer, but it can't communicate with the controller mode of the different MPCs for some reason. Now, also keep in mind that I'm shooting this video in the middle of May of 2021, and it feels like things become compatible with this new platform and macOS Big Sur every single week. So who knows, maybe we'll have full compatibility with the MPC hardware in controller mode with the software in a few days, weeks, months, or whatever. who am I to say? Oh, I also want to add right here that I did install Serato Studio and Serato Sample, and they work just great. Same goes for Reason, which I'm trying to get back into a little bit. It runs just fine on the M1 Mac Mini. And I also tried to install Ableton Live because some people asked me about that, even though I'm not really an Ableton Live user. So I talked to a friend of mine and he said, well, it works flawlessly on his M1 MacBook Pro. In my case, I couldn't install it because my trial period had expired. So yeah, back to the stuff. One thing that I've noticed though is that every single manufacturer or developer of third-party plugins or instruments that I've looked into myself, normally they don't make a big deal or tell any secrets about whether it's compatible or not with this new M1 chip or Big Sur. I use a lot of stuff from Native Instruments here myself, and you know, the stuff I use on the daily works on the computer, no issues at all, but they have a list on their website saying what stuff aren't compatible, which is a good thing to look into before you buy a new computer, diving headfirst into a new system. However, it's kind of becoming an issue to not be able to run some of the stuff that I depend on this computer. For instance, Ozone 8 from iZotope isn't compatible with this, so maybe I'm gonna have to upgrade to Ozone 9, which should be compatible according to their website. And the same thing goes for Arturia. I really enjoy a lot of the Arturia instruments that I have on my computer, and most of them seem to run just fine in standalone mode on Mac OS Big Sur. But as they say on their website, everything isn't fully tested out yet, and the compatibility issues with the M1 Macs inside of different DAWs, in my case Logic, just doesn't work at all, and sometimes it shows up but it looks kind of funny and it doesn't work as it's supposed to work, and I'm just sure that it's gonna stay like this for a while for some developers. Some people might again drop an update next week and some other stuff won't be compatible for a while. And thankfully I still have this computer if I need to run Ozone 8 for instance, which I'm gonna have to do for this 5 weeks of Beats project. So it's not all sunshine and happiness. Some stuff doesn't work and we're gonna have to be patient and wait for the updates to come out and the compatibility to be there, but again, do the homework and check out the different websites and read up on whether your favorite plugin or instrument or whatever is compatible or not. And for someone like me that uses a lot of different hardware as well as software, you know, it's unfortunate to not be able to run Pigments too. That's unfortunate, but it's not the end of the world because I have, you know, other plugins and different softwares, and I also have hardware synths that doesn't sound the same, but I can still use them. But if you're looking for a solution where you can just run everything and everything just works out of the box, maybe it's a little bit too early to dive into the M1 system of computers. And another thing that I hear a lot of people talk about when it comes to the M1 Mac Mini is that the connectivity is just not good enough. And honestly, I can't say that I totally agree there, because I come from this MacBook, again, which has 4 USB-C connections, nothing else. So I'm already living the dongle life, and I set up this computer with a lot of different dongles and USB hubs and stuff. Everything works just fine. So what I'm using here is actually one of those HyperDrive dongles. It's a pretty large one and it connects to the Thunderbolt port on the M1 Mac Mini. That gives me a bunch of USB-A ports as well as an SD card reader and a place to connect my external monitor. And the secondary Thunderbolt connection on the computer itself goes straight into my Apollo X8 audio interface because it kind of needs that in order to run efficiently. The 2 USB-A ports on the computer comes in nicely because one of them just goes to another USB-A hub that I have underneath my desk, sending USB to my DJ mixer and to my Complete Control keyboard, to my machine controller and an external SSD drive and stuff. And the other USB connection is actually not connected to anything right now. It's nice to have at least one port that's not occupied by anything. And before I got this computer, I actually wasn't sure that I could like put this much stress on the Thunderbolt connections on the computer. You know, I have my external monitor connected over HDMI into the HyperDrive USB hub that goes into the computer over USB-C Thunderbolt thing. For some reason, that just works a lot better for me than having the monitor connected over HDMI straight into the computer. I can't explain that. I don't know why. It just works better. And I have this 4K monitor that I have to use in 2K right now, because when I did it in 4K, the monitor was flickering and turned black and turned on and off and whatever. Someone told me to buy this kind of expensive 8K HDMI cable, and apparently that would work better. But I don't know, I haven't done that yet, and so far the computer monitor runs in 2K, which isn't optimal, but it works, and I think it's fine for now. So what I was saying was that I was a bit worried to like overdrive the USB-C connections with dongles connected to dongles connected to hubs. But that hasn't been an issue at all. I'm running my monitor like that, and I'm also able to run my Cam Link into the same USB hub and stream video in 1080p with pretty much no problems at all. And that's also coming from a person that uses external SSDs like this one for pretty much everything. On this one, for instance, I have my complete library on SSD, just one USB-C connection into the hub, and everything just works. And I do the same thing for all my video files as well. You know, buying a computer from Apple with a bigger internal storage costs a lot, and since I also have this laptop around, I want to be able to use external SSD drives like that instead. So right now, I think I have three different external SSDs connected in different ports here, and it just runs. So sure, some compatibility issues with some softwares and plugins, that's going to be an issue and a situation we'll have to live with for a while if we are using the M1 Max. But in terms of hardware and performance and stuff, I don't have anything negative to say about the M1 Mac Mini. And not to be too much of an Apple fanboy, even though I'm definitely an Apple fanboy, what I paid for this computer with 16 gigs of RAM and half a terabyte of storage is so much less. It's so much cheaper than this massive 15-inch laptop that I used to use. I felt like this was kind of a no-brainer to just get this computer and try it out. Now, if I wouldn't be able to do anything other than video editing on it, I would kind of be satisfied with that, because I had some issues before. But now, since I'm able to run pretty much everything I need, and I'm also transitioning to work even more with audio files than any MIDI and software instruments running on the computer, and this one just does that job really, really, really well. I'm also falling back in love with the Rolly Seaboard block. This runs on the M1 without any problems at all, and it really adds something a bit special. I'm not saying that this one replaces all the stuff that I normally use from Arturia inside of Logic, but, you know, we just have to stay flexible and explore some new or old stuff as we wait for these developers to adapt and update their plugins and products to support this new platform. So I guess my main tip here is that if you're not like me and you have access to like a lot of synths and stuff, you really rely heavily on a few different pieces of software, just do your homework and do a little bit of research online and see whether your favorite pieces of software is compatible or not before diving into the M1 system of computers. But let's also have a little bit of faith in these developers. Like, adjusting to a brand new system like this has to be a lot of work. And I'm sure it's gonna take some time, right? But all of a sudden, we're going to get a new Mac with the M2 or M1X processor. For a developer to long-term just not support this new system, I guess it's not going to be an option for a lot of developers, right? So let's try to end this. My conclusion here is that I really enjoy this computer a lot for what I do. It can't really do everything that I'm used to, but it's fast and it feels way more reliable than my old setup. But my first month of using this for everything, I'm positive, I'm optimistic, I'm happy, and I'm satisfied. This was a good purchase for me, definitely. I mean, this entire 5 weeks of beats project wouldn't be possible at all to do on my old computer. This one really made my live streams just bump up to a new level, and I like that. So I guess that's at least some of my thoughts after using the M1 Mac Mini for my creative work for a month. Hopefully this gave you something. Thanks a lot for watching this video. I hope to see you guys in the next one. And don't miss my live stream this Friday, the first one of my 5 weeks of Beats series. Again, it's gonna be fun. But until then, ha det godt. Accurate Beats.